Three.
Good morning, everyone, on this beautiful sunshiny day. I'm not sure how long we'll have the sunshine, but it's nice to see it anyway. The theme for today's message is from 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. If we walk in the light, God himself being the light, we will also experience a shared life with one another, as the sacrificial blood of Jesus, God's Son, purges all of our sin. For announcements this morning, I don't have much other than to say if anyone would like a bulletin in order to follow along with the Sunday services, and you don't have the email access, please contact the office and we will mail one to you, or if you do have email and are not getting it, we can add you to our listserv. So we'll take care of that. Gracious and holy God, we come seeking an awareness of your presence and desiring your wisdom and guidance. By the work of your Holy Spirit, grant us eyes to behold you and ears to listen for your words, hearts to love you, and lives that serve you. Amen. Now we'll sing our first hymn, Be Thou My Vision, which is number 451 if you have a hymnal, and we're singing verses 1 and 2.
Thank you, Beth and Kim, for sharing your talents with us today in music. I want to invite us into a time of prayer. Let's prepare our hearts in just a moment of silence. Let us pray. Amazing God, you are a God of hospitality. There is none like you that invites all to come to you. You have invited all to your home, to your table, and to your arms. us to remember that no one is better than anyone else in your kingdom, that you treat all as people who are loved. Help us then to treat each other the same way, because you treat us with your amazing love and grace. We take time now to pray for our friends, for family members, and for others who need you more than ever in these days. In just a moment of silence, we lift up those that we are remembering today. Oh God, pour out your healing, your courage, your strength, your hope on all who need it. Be active with your transforming love for those who desperately need it in their lives. Bring forth your reconciliation in families, communities, nations, and a world where it is badly needed. It is you who give us the gifts of the Spirit to use to further your kingdom. You who call us to be the body of Christ in the world. Help us to continue to be your hands and feet, and so to continue the work that needs to be done in so many places. There is none like you, God, in your love, your generosity, your gifting, your amazing hospitality. We thank you that you are in our lives, working in and through us. And help us to let people know that your kingdom is open to all. We pray these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, who opened the doors for all and continues to break down barriers that keep people from you. It is in his name and in his Spirit that we pray the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. And all God's people said, invite us now to hear the witness of Scripture.
We have two scriptures this morning, both from the first letter of John, not to be confused with the Gospel of John. The first is from chapter 1, verses 5 through 10. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. And the second scripture is from chapter 2, verses 7 through 10. Beloved, I am writing you no new commandment, but an old commandment that you have had from the beginning. The old commandment is a word that you have heard. Yet I am writing you a new commandment that is true in him and in you, because the darkness is passing away, and the true light is already shining. Whoever says I am in the light while hating a brother or sister is still in the darkness. Whoever loves a brother or sister lives in the light, and in such a person there is no cause for stumbling. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.
The words of Scripture are powerful words, aren't they? And when I think about them, I think that it's not a black and white kind of reality, at least for me. An image that I would use is that I sometimes take my grandchildren to their daycare in the morning. And it's about 8 o'clock, so right now the sun is coming up. And as I'm driving, I have to go to the east for a bit. And when I pick them up in the evening, the sun is in the west. And about 5 o'clock, it's already starting to come down below the tree lines. And so part of the time, I am driving in sunlight. And part of the time, the trees and the buildings are kind of creating already a sense of dusk, of darkness. And for me, that is a metaphor in my own life. I wish that I could always walk in the light. And maybe you do too. But there are things that hook me emotionally. Jesus tells us that we're supposed to love our enemies, right? And sometimes that's easy to do when they're more abstract, when they're out there. But when we have been hurt, and we perceive those folks as the enemy in some way, someone who has hurt us deeply, that's harder to do. I am, and always have been, a big fan of the writer Frederick Buechner. And I appreciate what he says very much about this. Sometimes I remember Pogo, the comic strip. Maybe some of you do too. And the most famous line in that comic strip is, "We have met the enemy and they are us." And usually that's been applied in a way to say, hey, we do things that are destructive wrong as well, and maybe we're the person that's creating part of the problem. But I think the other way to hear that, the way I've been hearing it lately, is that we have met the enemy, that other, but they are also human like us. They come with all their fears, their anxieties, their hurts, their perception of what has happened, their reality, their grievances, and in some ways they view us, perhaps, as the enemy as well. And yet Jesus calls us to love our enemies. And so Buechner says this. He says, Jesus tells us to love our enemies, not love in an emotional sense, not a romantic sense or even a warm feeling toward our enemies, but in the sense that we are willing their good. We are willing the best for are willing a full humanity for them, and sometimes we see that their actions, sometimes like our own actions, diminish the image of God within us. He says it's a tall order to love our enemies. Should African Americans love white supremacists? Should the longtime employee who was laid off just weeks before he or she qualifies for a pension love those who have called them in? Should the mother of a molested child love the molester? But when you see very clearly who your enemies are, the hope is that we might see our enemies also. That we might see the lines on their faces, that we might know and begin to identify something of the struggles, the stuff in their life that makes them act the way we they do, in the same way that we sometimes can get better in touch with the way we act like we do, because of our background, our family, what's happened to us, our life experience. Maybe sometimes we can see that they're vulnerable, they're scared, they're confused, they don't know what to do. Now, sometimes still, with that exercise, cannot bring myself to love my enemies. I was having a lot of trouble a couple of weeks ago with the storming of the Capitol. And I had some very negative thoughts, probably as negative as the rioters, except on the other side. And so sometimes I am light years away from loving them. But at least I can recognize that they are as human as I am. At least if I cannot love them, I could at least take the step of asking God to be with them as I'm asking God to be with me. If only God would forgive them because I can. Maybe that's the beginning of a prayer. My father-in-law, who I disagreed with in many, many ways, had bits of wisdom, though, that I could not ignore. And one of them was that he would rather consistently say, now, before you get all judgmental about something, try to think about why are they acting in the crazy, wild, confused, hurtful way that they are. What is happening in their own life to do that? So he had a bit of compassion. And I think we need to do that too. The scriptures are very clear that we are to walk in the light. And I try to do that, but it's kind of like when I drive to pick up the kids. You know, things get in the way. The tree line gets in the way. The buildings get in the way. And for a while, my life moves twilight, if not in darkness. And so I need to be reminded that the challenge, the way that I need to pray when I come to God, is that I would be able to walk in the light, that I would not hate a brother or sister in Christ. Because when I looked at what was happening and began to hear more about the folks at the Capitol that day on the 6th of January, I got to wonder if many of them had patches God's Patriot, or they carried even Jesus signs, Jesus 2020. They are my brothers and sisters in Christ. And I need to find ways to reach out to them and to find ways to build bridges, or we will be separated by this terrible gulf of these negative feelings toward each other, this violence. Proverbs 25 says that we should give our enemy food and give them drink. And then that strange little line, in so doing, you will heap burning coals of fire on their head. That doesn't sound nice, does it? I mean, put hot coals from your cookout on somebody's head? What's that image supposed to be saying? Paul quotes it, actually. Maybe it is the warming of the person. Maybe it is the realization that kind of that you get when you touch something hot, you know? But maybe I need to rethink who I am, what I'm doing. I've been very touched in the last few years by a comment I read. A man who had been in a white supremacist group was at a McDonald's, and he had placed his order. African American woman could see on his arm, could see a Nazi swastika tattoo. And as she put the order before him, she just kind of put her hand near that and she said, honey, you're better than that. He says that phrase stuck with him. You're better than that. It stuck with him for months until he began to examine his own self. In some ways, along with the food and drink, she had put some coals, maybe not hot burning, but enough to start warming and stimulating his mind to think about who he was and what he was doing. Paul tells us in Romans 12 that we are not to be overcome by evil, but to overcome evil with good. It's not always easy to do, but it is our calling as the people of God. And when we fail, and I fail often in this idea of loving someone who I feel hurt by or angry about, forgiveness, and I know that I will receive it, but not just leave it there. Ask God to also transform me in a way that can heal the divisions between us. And I pray that for all of us, because we all have moments in our lives, in our relationships, our families, our political life together in this country, just all the different ways in which life rubs up against each other with a terrible kind of friction, and ways in which we need to bring the heat down, to find ways that instead of reaching out to one another, we can join our hands together, at least in recognizing our common humanity and our need to be a people who work together. I pray that for us in these very difficult days. It is my desire, and maybe yours too, that I want to follow Jesus. And so I invite us now to sing. It's hymn number 396, if you have a hymnal. And by the way, if you don't have a hymnal, and you keep saying, hey, if you have a hymnal, Pastor, oh, we don't have a hymnal, you can call the church office and we'll check you out, both a hymnal and a black Faith We Sing songbook to use while we're being online. But I invite us to sing it. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 3, and hopefully Kim will step up to the mic again. Lynn will, and she will help us as we sing together.
Song gets to you, doesn't it? My goodness, it gets to me. Now is the time we remind ourselves that there is still business that must be conducted for our church, and our offerings and gifts are still needed. If you have internet access, by all means, you can do that on the website, and there are instructions on doing that on the website. You can also mail or drop off church. Our January mission offering is, and I apologize if I slaughter the name, we will be supporting our missionary Temba Nkomo Zeppi, who serves as an agriculturalist in Zambia. So blessings for them and on our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious God, as we offer these gifts, we also offer ourselves, asking you to give us the strength and courage, wisdom and grace to live as your your people in these challenging days. Thank you for all of your gifts to us, most especially the gift of yourself in Jesus, our Lord and teacher, healer and savior. Amen. Our closing hymn is one that, did you have anything you'd like to say about that?
Yeah, I can say a word. Yeah.
Okay.
Some people say, oh, it's a new hymn. You know, why do we have to sing new hymns? Well, at one time, every hymn was a new hymn, right? And one of the really great new hymn writers in our time is Carolyn Winfred Gillette. Carolyn is a deacon in the Presbyterian Church, and she is a prolific hymn writer. She may write eventually as many hymns as they say Charles Wesley wrote. About one a week is what she's cranking out. And some of them are very good. This one especially I had noted and saved for this particular Sunday. She wrote it last year, toward the end of last year, in the midst of all of our divisions. It's called God of Love, We've Known Division. But then it's a prayer to move beyond that. And I hope that we will take that to heart as we sing. Read just the last verse of that hymn. God, you have challenged us to goodness. You have shown a kinder way. It's your love that now inspires us as we seek a better day. May we end our harsh division. May we stop the hate and fear. Make us one Lord as a nation. May we be united here. That is our prayer as we send ourselves off, reminding ourselves that we are made in, by, and for love, by the one who created us in love, by the Christ who came among us to be the witness to us of that amazing, costly love, and by the Holy Spirit that would bind us ever closer in both the comfort and the challenge of that love. May you and I go today seeking to walk as well as we can.